In June of 2022, I offered an explanation of why dark matter doesn't exist. That line of reasoning came directly from an application of the properties of the electric sun model. Now, the mainstream accepted model has no way to describe or explain dark matter. I presented that discussion in my latest book, The Interconnected Cosmos. And also in there are explanations of several other phenomena that can only be understood by referencing the properties of the electric sun model. One of these is the so-called solar wind. Now, a gigantic flow of electrically charged particles is more accurately called an electric current. But astronomers had already completely convinced themselves that there was no possibility of separated charges moving through interplanetary space when in 1962, the Mariner 2 space probe that was on its way to Venus detected it. Astronomers didn't know what to make of this. Ignoring the earlier 1908 prediction by Christian Birkeland that electric corpuscles such as this would indeed be discovered, Eugene Parker named the flow the solar wind, effectively robbing from Birkeland the recognition he so richly deserved for his now validated prediction. Also, naming it a wind successfully camouflaged its true electrical nature. Anyway, later, the Ulysses solar probe discovered that this wind came in two varieties, an irregular, relatively slow type of flow with speeds of up to 400 kilometers per second. That's not slow, but there's also a fast one with speeds up to twice that, 800 kilometers per second. So there are two different types of two different speeds of these two different solar winds. The slow one typically comes from the sun's equatorially located so-called streamer belt. The fast type comes from the relatively peaceful surface that we see when we look down through coronal holes at the normal surface of the smooth photosphere. In my book, I point out that some skeptics have made much of the idea that electrons are found in both the fast and slow solar winds, along with positive ions. Yes, that's true, but it doesn't mean that the net flow of charge is zero. In a plasma, electrons and ions are separated. If they weren't, we wouldn't have a plasma. We would have a simple neutral gas flow. But in interplanetary space, they are separated. Negative electrons are generally attracted toward the positively charged sun, and positive ions are repelled by that sun. These forces are generally relatively weak. An interplanetary electric field of only a few volts or even microvolts per kilometer is sufficient, given that it extends over millions of kilometers, to accelerate those solar wind ions to speeds of 400 kilometers per second and 800 kilometers per second. But consider what occurs when an electron moving in toward the sun approaches an ion that is moving outward away from the sun. As the ion and the electron get closer to each other, the attractive force between them increases. The strength of the attractive force applied to the positive ion is exactly equal to the force applied to the electron. These are purely attractive electrical forces, and they're equal because both particles have exactly the same amount of electric charge, and they are of an opposite sign. But the ion has about 1,800 times the mass of the electron. It's sort of like a tug of war between a mouse running in one direction and an elephant going in the other direction. They're both pulling with the same amount of force on a stretched spring between them, but the elephant, the plus ion, continues merrily on his trajectory, carrying the poor mouse, the electron, roughly in his direction. The ion does not capture the electron, because recombination would quench the plasma. So the electron often ends up being dragged along by the ion, but wildly oscillating around the ion at what is called the plasma frequency. So how does the electric sun model explain the two different solar winds? The essence of the electric sun is shown in this image. In this diagram, the horizontal axis of each plot is the radial distance outward from a point just below the sun's photospheric surface. That surface is opaque. We can't see down through it. That's why some people think that is a surface. The top plot shows how the voltage changes as we go out from the surface. that it isn't really a surface, it's a layer. But it's analogous to what we would get if we plotted a cross-section of the dam at the end of a reservoir that holds back water. The middle plot shows three different charge layers that create that voltage distribution. They are three very thin concentric spherical shells that surround the sun. The height of those triangular regions that you see show the force per unit charge that a positive ion would experience at those various radial distances. A positive value of that is an outward force. So any ion that can get to a point in the chromosphere, this would be between points B and D, will fall down the voltage hill just like a ball rolls down a hill. Dropping down the voltage hill makes the ion go faster and faster. In other words, it accelerates. Its velocity is plotted in the bottom curve. This next image shows what happens normally when the level of the most energetic ions within the body of the sun have just enough energy to leak over the top of the voltage dam. The purple is the water, and you can see it just being a little higher than the photospheric tuft, and it's leaking over the top there. If the effective height of the dam can be varied, the volume, that's called the density of flow, how much stuff is flowing there, can be varied. This flow, as it passes out of the image toward the lower right, experiences turbulence. This is measured as the temperature of the ion flow. This creates the anomalous, extremely high temperature of the lower corona that begins here, something like 2 million Kelvin. Clearly, our dam on the sun is electrical, not made of steel and cement that holds back a fluid. It's made from what astronomers call photospheric granules, but plasma scientists call them anode tufts. The flow as it moves off to the right is called the fast solar wind. Its velocity is due solely to the height of the dam, the height of the voltage drop through which the ions fall. Its density, that is how many amperes it contains or how many gallons per minute are flowing, is controlled by the height of the floodgate, the little floodgate at the top. And a very minor movement of that floodgate can really change the amount of the flow. The solar wind actually stopped for a day or two a few years ago. How? Why? Did somebody raise the floodgate and cut the water flow? Needless to say, the standard model has no explanation for this phenomenon, but the electric sun does. The higher the face of the dam, the greater the velocity of the water when it gets to the bottom. It's just that simple. But what happens if in some region the dam is taken away? Visualize somebody blows a hole in the dam or the dike breaks. Then water, or ions in our case, would flood out from the reservoir. The density of the flood would be greater, more gallons per second, more amperes. But the velocity would be lower because the stuff would be falling from a lower height, not over the top of the dam wall, which is way up high. A lower voltage in the real case, a lower height from the water analogy. The real explanation is obvious from this diagram. This is the same cross-section we saw earlier, but a sunspot is a place where there is no photospheric tuft that to create a dam. So if you remove the black line, what all you're left with is the interior of the sun there is at voltage V1 on that vertical axis. And the ions, you can see the red curve, just flood outward from that out toward the lower corona. They're not restrained in any way. As the path of the ions coming through the granules, the one on the top, they have to get up over that higher voltage, V2. And then they fall higher, it's steeper drop down to where they created some turbulence. But anyway, a sunspot is a place where there are no photospheric tufts to create the dam, and the sun's internal energy being at voltage V1, and the energy level of the dam itself is V2, so in a sunspot, the internal ions are unrestrained and are able to get out of the sun by just falling from level V1. So they aren't going as fast as those that fall all the way down from level V2. And this is how the slow solar wind is created from sunspots. The voluminous but relatively slow-moving ions of the slow solar wind flow easily up and out of a sunspot. So we see here the same region of the sun in all three images. The top picture is the photosphere, which is the innermost layer, the closest to the center of the sun, the one that's at lowest solar altitude, if you want to think of it that way. And it obviously includes a beautiful big sunspot group. The middle picture is taken at a slightly higher level than the one at the top, and it's of the chromosphere. And in reality, that's, of course, above the photosphere. And the bottom picture is higher still in altitude, and it's a picture of the lower part of the corona, which extends outward from that point out to several radiuses of the values of the sun. So the layer that's at the lowest altitude on the sun, the photosphere, is at the top in this image. And the layer that's located at the highest solar altitude, the lower corona, appears in the bottom of the image. You can see the effect of ions that pour up from the sunspots. They create a high level of turbulence when they enter the chromosphere, and even more when they hit the lower corona. So you can see they're white. The photosphere is covered by granulation. It consists of closely packed plasma tufts. The chromosphere is a layer that begins about 250 miles above the photosphere, and it's about 1,000 miles thick. The lower corona begins just above the chromosphere, and it extends outward a distance of several solar radii. The dark region at the bottom left of this image is a coronal hole. It's simply an area in the sun's corona that's located above a nice, normal, quiescent photospheric region that is devoid of any sunspots or other irregularities. These holes are associated with the quiet sun. It may seem to an inexperienced person and to some scaremongers on the internet that coronal holes are something to be feared or worried about. They aren't. They're just not disturbed regions from which coronal mass ejections or any other violent ejections of matter usually emanate. They're peaceful regions. More than any other area, such as the streamer belt, it's a normal region on the sun where the photosphere has a smooth appearance and tufting is relatively uniform and undisturbed. And that's where the fast solar wind comes from. Let me summarize the important properties of the so-called solar winds. First, there's a factor of two difference between the maximum velocities of the two winds. Secondly, the density of the slow wind is well over that of the fast wind. The amount of matter, the amount of stuff in the slow wind is 85% greater than in the more controlled fast wind. Slow wind just pours out of an open hole, so that's why there's more material in it. Thirdly, temperature is a measure of the random excitement motion of the particles in a plasma. In the fast wind, this level is 6 times greater than in the slow wind. In the fast wind, ions collide forcefully with the bottom of their great fall. Slow wind ions easily escape without falling through a great voltage drop, so they're not as turbulent as the fast solar wind. Fourth, the random motion of electrons in the two winds are relatively in the same order of magnitude, the slow wind electrons being only about 30% more excited than those in the fast wind. But this observation was made at roughly Earth's distance from the sun. Now, if you realize that the electrons in both winds at that point are coming in toward the sun from the outer regions of the solar system, and so they have not yet been through the mixing effects of the scrambling effects of the tuft voltage drops just above the photosphere. That lies in their future when they get closer in. Fifth, in the electric sun model, the turbulence of the fast wind ions is caused by their falling through this high voltage drop. And that explains the extreme temperature of the lower corona, which has baffled astronomers for decades. Sixth and final, the electric sun model explains the fluctuations in the volume, that is to say, the quantity of material in the fast solar wind, and how it once was cut off for more than a day. Now, none of these six observed facts are explained by the standard model of cosmology. They all result from electrical forces that the ions experience. They're prime pieces of evidence of the validity of the electric sun model, which is a major component of the overall electric universe hypothesis, or the electric universe model of cosmology. In the standard model, their eyes are wide shut to the obvious presence of electricity in the cosmos. But those that use common sense and think for themselves can see the magnificence of our truly electric universe. How long do you think it'll be before astronomers open their eyes to what is actually going on in the cosmos? Is conventional science presently living in a reincarnation of the Middle Ages, where there was a privileged class consisting of the king, the nobles, and the clergy, who held all the power? The general population believed whatever the nobility told them. And the ascendance of real empirical science would not emerge for many centuries to come, until enough people caught on that the emperor had no clothes.